into Section 12. And Section 12 deals with national information policy. Obviously, if we recognize that information is important in national development, then it means that there should be a policy nationally that will guide the generation and the usage of information. And that's what we want to discuss in this session. So in terms of an outline, we'll be looking at what we mean by policy, information policy. We'll look at the right to information. We'll look at information as a national resource. Look at the need for a national information policy, and then stakeholders in the development of information policy. We will identify stakeholders in the development of information policy. Then we'll look at the African Information Society initiative. By way of introduction, what is a policy? Generally, it is a public statement of intention that is usually, but not always, formulated and clearly expressed by a government, institutions, or other organizations. You can also have a social group or club or even an individual practicing a profession. Then information policies. Information policies is a class of or a subset of policies in general. That is, information policies deal with some components of the production, organization, retrieval, and communication of data or information within an enterprise or within a country. National information policy. National information policy is a blueprint that is expected to guide a society, e.g. a nation, in its progress towards the knowledge economy or towards the information society. A set of decisions taken by government through appropriate laws and regulations in order to arrange the harmonious development of information transfer activities. The right to information. The right to information is recognized internationally as one of the universal human rights, and it is reflected in the 1992 Constitution of Ghana, where Article 21, Section 1, Clause 1, Clause F, says that governments, ministries, departments, and agencies should make it a responsibility. It makes it a responsibility of governments to provide access to such information through the mandatory provision of a right to information law. We have talked about the right to information law already, which hasn't seen the light of day in the past 25 years. Now, the right to information versus availability of information. Critical shortage of information in most sub-Saharan African countries. In a lot of sub-Saharan African countries, we have a problem with access to information. The information is there at a global level or internationally, but then because of some problems that were identified earlier on in the earlier discussions, it is difficult for us to have access to this information. Information as a national resource. Again, we have seen how information is important in national development. For example, the United Nations identifies information as a basis for knowledge, and that's why it has declared it as a human right. It has also been declared as a public good. We saw it when we were looking at the economics of information. Now, information also required for professional services and for socio-cultural development. These are also things that we have identified already. So what we are doing is that we are building the ground towards the need for a national information policy. Information is indispensable in national development, as we have identified. It is required in the rational use of national resources for the development of our human resource, for scientific and technological development, for progress in agriculture, industry, and commerce, and for the brewing of culture and the enhancement of social well-being. Now, how do you manage information as a resource? Every enterprise or resource has four objectives in mind when it acquires, processes, stores, utilizes, or distributes and disposes of unwanted resources. These objectives are: one, to obtain the resource as cheaply as possible, to maximize the value obtained from using the resource, to ensure a constant and uninterrupted supply of the resource, and to make somebody accountable or responsible for the achievement of the foregoing objectives, which is why we need to have a national information policy to guide us through all these. African initiatives. The African Union has developed, The African Union should have projects that have an information component. Fortunately, AU 2063, which has been carved out of the UN Agenda 20, 30 identifies the importance of libraries and other information centers in national development. We have the Pan-African Development Information System, PADIS, which is a centralized bibliographic database of development information, and all African countries can have access to. There is also the African Information Society Initiative, or IC for short, which provides an ICT-based framework for accelerating Africa's entry into the information society. There is the efforts of UNESCO, and then the ECA, that is the Economic Community of Africa. Now, looking ahead, African countries should revive the information policy debate that has been going on since the 1980s. In Ghana, for example, we don't have a national information policy. African countries need to take into consideration the increasing dominant role of ICT in information management. We should also pursue the IC's, that is African Information Society Initiative, ICT-led agenda to its logical conclusion. Librarians should also widen their scope of stakeholders to include not just information personnel, but also scientists, researchers, policymakers, planners, and even ordinary information users. We also need to establish information systems and services that will make information as a vital commodity, which will be accessible to the user when he or she needs it, and with little or no wastage of his or her time. The need for a national information policy. Rationale for information policy development. Within the African context, there is a need for a national information policy because of our peculiar problems that we have, problems of illiteracy, problems of power generation, and problems of information that comes in foreign languages. And so Africa needs to overcome fundamental information problems of weak or non-existent physical infrastructure, shortage of qualified personnel. Again, these are things that we have identified earlier on, insufficient awareness by African bureaucrats and policymakers of the true relevance of information in decision making, problem solving, and national development. I have identified already, or pointed out to you already, that in our parts of the world, we hardly put much premium on information. There are people who don't even believe that they need information. There's a chronic lack of funds for and indifferent funding of information programs. If you take the Ghana Library Authority, for example, sometime in the mid-80s to the 90s, there were times when no funding was given for the purchase of books, so they had to rely on donations. Fundamental information problems, obstacles in the way of national information policy development. We have government officials and decision makers who lack knowledge on the usefulness of information. There is also the library profession, which has a low image, and then there's a lack of success to prepare project plans. We have the issues of national information services and systems, which are usually based on a single under-resourced, understaffed, and underdeveloped final point. There's also lack of national information policy. The impact of new technologies is positives and negatives. The positive, it will enable new knowledge to be produced, organized, and packaged, and retrieved, transmitted, and then applied together with old knowledge. There is also the cyberspace to consider, the web, www, virtual learning, that is e-based distance education, which you are practicing now. The negatives of it is that we will have criminal fraud activities on the internet. This is also not new. I'm sure you know the meaning of Sakawa already. The stakeholders and development of information policy. Everybody is a player in the policy formulation process, and the government is a lead player. And then the information industry, that is information professionals and institutions, information users, both current and potential, are also players. Professional associations and societies, we have industry groups, have educational institutions, including schools, colleges, universities, among others. These are all players or stakeholders in the policy formulation process. We also have health institutions. They are also players or stakeholders in the policy process. Non-governmental organizations, civil society organizations, private citizens, consumer protection groups, these are all stakeholders in the bid for national information policy. In terms of the scope of the policies, we have broad policy scope, which should involve all sectors, which should be put together in a comprehensive whole. This will offer government the advantage of setting broad policy objectives that will cover the different national information institutions and activities. It may be difficult to achieve in the short term, so it should be a long-term goal. But a narrow policy scope will involve the development of partial policies for subsectors like agriculture, area of education, the environment, health, and then ICT. Then we need to link the national information policy with other policy areas like science and technology policy, education policy, public and state security policy, the general legal system, overall economic policy, taxation policy. Now, the various stages that can be considered will include goal setting, problem identification, policy development, policy implementation, and policy review. Now, the major players in the stages, we have UNESCO's guidelines edited by Horton, for example, which has identified four areas, that is policy assessment, decision and approval, second one, policy planning and strategizing, the third one, policy implementation, and finally, policy housekeeping, additions, deletions, and changes. Now, the African Information Society Initiative, which I have spoken about briefly, there are external factors as well as internal factors. 400 years of slavery has deprived Africa of a lot of human resource and a lot of initiatives. Over 100 years of colonialism, there is a huge debt burden. I'm sure you have been hearing the news about the Ghana's economy. Same thing applies elsewhere in other African countries. There is also the unequal terms of trade, where we sell primary products, which we don't even sell at our own prices, but we sell at the prices of the industrialized countries. And then they sell in turn to us finished products at very exorbitant prices. Internal factors, the senseless coup d'etats, the civil wars and conflicts that used to plague our nation some years back. There's also the issue of dictatorship, tyranny and oppression, and then corruption and maladministration. I'm sure you have been listening to the news in Ghana. There's also gross abuse of human rights, including murder and torture of opponents of governments. Some benefits that may be derived from the African Information Society Initiative: agriculture and food security, in the area of education and research, in the area of health, gender and development, trade and commerce. Stakeholders, implementation of plans, and challenges, achievements, impact of the IC program. These are all challenges and achievements in the terms of implementing the African Information Society Initiatives. In a nutshell, this is what this session has been about. That is the way forward for a national information policy that would be able to garner and utilize the information that is available internally and out there in the rest of the world. And these are references that will also help you to understand better what we have been discussing so far. Thank you for your time.